All right, everyone. So I'll be introducing our next speaker, Larry E. Schweikart. Larry E. Schweikart is a former rock drummer who opened for Steppenwolf. He is an American historian and the author of more than a dozen books. Dr. Schweikart was born on April 21st, 1951 in Mesa, Arizona, and he lived in Hegley, Arizona, where his father, Earl, was a ranch foreman for the Dougherty Ranch. Earl was a rodeo roper and excellent horseman. In 1961, Earl died, and Mr. Schweikart moved with his mother, Eunice, to Chandler, where he attended Chandler High School from 1964 to 1968. He was then enrolled into Arizona State University in the political science program. Throughout his high school and college, however, Dr. Schweikart spent most of his time playing drums in a variety of rock bands, and in 1972, upon graduation, he joined a band called Gold Mine, led by John Tatum, formerly of the Earwigs, which was the forerunner to Alice Cooper, who I hope you guys all know. Tatum and his wife, Alice, currently a jazz singer in Phoenix, fleshed out the band with several other musicians, and over a period of about 2 years, the band played clubs in the Midwest, Southwest, and Canada. Dr. Schweikart left the band in the mid-1970s, returning to Arizona, where he re-entered ASU to obtain a teaching certificate, taking a history course that inspired him to become a history professor. He entered the ASU's master's program, publishing two national Phi Alpha Theta prize-winning articles in consecutive years, at that point the only time that had ever occurred. Upon receiving the MA, he was admitted to UCSB, also known as UC Santa Barbara, and had already published his first book, A History of Banking in Arizona. During his study at UCSB, he published his second book, A Study of the Trident Submarine Program, with his former professor at ASU, D. Douglas Dowglish. Graduating in 1984, Larry Schweikart took a one-year position at the University of Wisconsin-Richland Center. Then, in 1985, he received an appointment to the University of Dayton. His doctoral dissertation, published as Banking in the American South, was awarded one of the top three economic history dissertations in the United States. Since arriving at UD, University of Dayton, Dr. Schweikart taught business and economic history, then military history. In the 1990s, he began to focus on trade books as opposed to academic or textbooks, beginning with the history of American business. The entrepreneurial adventure then, in 2004, after almost a decade of research and writing, he co-authored the best-selling U.S. history book, A Patriot's History of the United States. He continued to publish major trade books on national defense, history, and historiography. Larry has become a close friend of YAF, speaking at both colleges and conferences. Theodore Roosevelt once said, "The more you know about the past, the better prepared you are for the future." With history books being rewritten by those who would seek to alter the past, we must rely on men like Larry to ensure that we can learn and grow from history. Plus, he was a rock star. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Larry Schweikart.
Well, thank you. I am no longer a professor of history. I just retired from the University of Dayton literally a month ago. And we bought a house in Arizona. And so my wife made the cross-country trip with my Yorkie named Milo. And he flew because he could fit under the seat. And I drove out with another friend and our other dog, Stanley, who was too big to fit under the seat, but he's pretty hyper, so we gave him a good dose of drugs that you see here, and he's like, man, I'm really burnt. Anyway, we get to the house out in Arizona at night, and we have a pool, of course, and Stan was used at home in Ohio to running out the deck, jumping off the deck, and landing in the yard and just flying around. First thing out the door, boosh, and he gets this look on his face like, who put water here in my backyard? So that was quite an experience for Stanley. And then came the heat. I mean, I grew up in Arizona. I know it's hot, but the first week we were there, it reached 119. And, you know, I forgot about Arizona. I have an iPod dock in my car, and I left the windows up. We went shopping in a mall, come back out. And this is what happened to my iPod. The sun had literally burnt a hole through the glass. So. Anyway, on to our topic. Yes, I'm no longer a professor, but I did used to be in a rock band. This was us after we opened for Steppenwolf. I am in the Jaws t-shirt there at the end. If you look at the shoes, you will see that all things go in cycles and that these platform shoes have come back again, you know. So if I'd hung on to mine, I probably could have sold them for a little bit. There's my little drum set. I'll tell you guys a story. This isn't in the script, but my idol growing up as a drummer was Carmine Appice. Now, he's not a big name like some of the other guys, like Neil Peart or some of the other drummers, but he was drummer for Vanilla Fudge and Cactus and wrote the first rock and roll drum book ever. He even was on ESPN doing commentary for drum and bugle corps stuff. I mean, rock and roll, you know. So he is my hero. I got a set just like his. I mean, I built my set to look just like Carmine's set. And with my hair and my Fu Manchu, I kind of looked like Carmine. So we opened for Steppenwolf at Tampa Convention Center, and there's maybe, I don't know, 15,000 people there. After our set, I go up in the rafters to look down on the stage to kind of see what we were doing. And this kid comes running up to me, goes, "Carmine, you were awesome!" And I went, thank you. So anyway, and that's Savoy Brown down there in the corner. In 2004, Mike Allen and I wrote a surprising bestseller, Patriot's History of the United States. This book ended up being a New York Times number one bestseller. As I say, it surprised us. We thought we were going to end up publishing this, self-publishing it, and selling it out of the back of a van, you know, like with ho-hos and ding-dongs and big gulps and, you know, plastic bags and things like that, good light bulbs you can't get anymore. It sold really well. It was reviewed by the Wall Street Journal and National Review, a bunch of other sources. I mean, it hit a kind of plateau for a number of years, kind of stayed up there in the top 100 of Amazon, but not going crazy. And then back in 2010, I was invited on the Glenn Beck show. Now, this is when Glenn Beck had 3.5 million viewers. To put that in perspective, that's 350 times better than CNN has on a good night. Okay? So we show up, and I give Glenn a copy of Patriot's History, and his response was, "I know this book. Do I know this book?" Well, anybody who's read Patriot's History, their response is usually, "This is a great book," unless you're just flaming liberal. "This is a good book," you know? So I knew he hadn't read the book. So I get back home. 4 days later, Glenn calls me at home. "Larry, this is Glenn Beck. Hey, I hadn't read the book when you were on the show." I know, Glenn. That's okay." He says, no, I read it over the weekend." Well, somebody had it here. I said, "Who had that book? Hold it up. So he read this over the weekend, right? 1,000 pages. And he said, "This is a great book." And so he starts going on his show every night, holding the book up 4, 5, 6 times with little yellow, "You got to get this book. This is the best history book ever written." Well, it goes right up to the top of Amazon, and pretty soon I get a call from the publisher. Publisher says, "Your book's going to be in the New York Times list next week." This is 6 years after it was published. That almost never happens. Yeah, well, that's great. That's really good. Now, our goal in writing it was to write for ordinary people, to write a history book that ordinary people would be excited about, interested in, not for scholars, you know. So next week, I get another call. "Larry, your book's going to be in the top 10 of the New York Times." I'm, "Wow, that's really good. Way to go." Next week, I get the call. And it's a conference call, and I can hear them in the background partying. You know, the champagne corks are popping. Woo! You know, you can hear the party going on. You know, "Larry, your book's going to be number one on the New York Times." I said, "Well, yeah, that's great." No, you don't get it. It's going to be number one on the New York." No, that's wonderful. "No, you don't. It's going to be in Target. It's going to be in Costco. It's going to be in Walmart." And I said, "Wait a minute. Our book's going to be in Walmart? Thank you, Jesus." Because that meant that we were reaching ordinary people that I wanted to read the book. So it ended up in the hands of a few well-known people. That's Adam Baldwin of the TNT show Last Ship. That's Christian Grammy artist Michael W. Smith. That's Nick Searcy of the show Justified. That's country star Clint Black. You probably know this guy. He just won another Super Bowl. Tom Brady. What else would a patriot be reading? After Patriot's History, the publisher suggested that I take on some of the debates that we had in the end notes. You know, what we do is we'd say, well, so-and-so says this, here's why they're wrong. And so that became a book called 48 Liberal Lies About American History that you probably learned in school. And so as we have more and more information on the internet, it becomes even harder to discern truth from fiction. And so one of the purposes of this was to look at what are the arguments that are out there and, you know, what is, as best I can tell, what's the truth. I looked at the top 20 U.S. history textbooks. A couple of them, like Howard Zinn's People's History, are not really textbooks, but they're used like textbooks, so I included those too. And what were these books saying? Well, what I found was rather shocking. One of the first things many of you do as students is look at the pictures. So I looked at the pictures in the 20th century section of these books, right? What's the most common picture you would find in an American history book in the 20th century section? Franklin Roosevelt. Okay. No argument there. Reasonable. I'd probably put him in there too. So that's pretty good. Second most common picture you find in the 20th century section of the textbooks. Something to do with the atomic bomb. Okay. That's right. That's legitimate. That's reasonable. What do you think would be the third most common picture in the 20th century? John F. Kennedy, moon landing, Martin Luther King, Ronald Reagan? No. Third most common picture in the 20th century section was the KKK. In the 20th century? Really? That's what defines the 20th century? How about this? You're looking at the same pictures in the Civil War section about Abraham Lincoln, and you find this guy, John Wilkes Booth, and every one of the textbooks correctly identified him as a Confederate. So how is this guy, Lee Harvey Oswald, the man who shot JFK, how is he identified in these textbooks? A Marine, former Marine, an ex-Marine. Only one of the 20 textbooks correctly identified him as a communist. In fact, if you saw the news just a few months ago, a newly released CIA document showed that Oswald visited our new buddy pal Cuba just a few weeks before the assassination. Suppose maybe they gave him a few tips like target practice or something. In my survey of the top 20 textbooks, I found that while not every textbook contained all 48 lies, even Zinn managed to miss a few. Most of them contain one, and all of them contain one, and most of them contain a few more than one. And what it suggests is an underlying mindset, not that these guys get together and deliberately write false history, but like a fish, they're swimming through the water of false history, and they essentially see America as racist, oppressive, imperialistic, and evil. Here are some of the most prominent of the liberal lies in the book. Number 19, the Rosenbergs were not spies and were wrongfully executed. The Rosenbergs, Julius and Ethel Rosenberg, were communist spies who gave the schematic to the atomic bomb to the KGB. And they were captured, the evidence was caught in their hands, and they were put on trial, convicted, and executed. I think she's the first woman to be executed by the federal government since Mary Surratt in the Civil War Lincoln assassination. So what do the textbooks say about this? Gene Boydston, book A Making of America, writes, Julius Rosenberg, a former member of the Communist Party, he was a current member, and his wife Ethel were convicted in a controversial trial on charges of conspiracy to commit espionage and sentenced to death in April 1951. The controversy over their guilt continues to the present day. Well, no, it doesn't. There may be controversy, but their guilt is established beyond a doubt, including by their longtime friend and mentor, Martin Sobel, who later in life said, yeah, Julius passed atomic bomb secrets to the Soviets. But that didn't stop the historians. Mark C. Carnes, in a book, American Destiny, writes, although they were no major spies, and the information they revealed was not important, the Rosenbergs were executed. Huh? Passing the biggest secret of the late 1940s to the most deadly weapon in human history to your avowed enemy is not important. You're not a major spy. What would you have to give away? Nude photos of Demi Lovato? Yet a third textbook and one of the worst, John Mac Farragher's Out of Many, said, quote, "The government's case against the Rosenbergs rested on testimony of their supposed accomplices, some of them secretly coached by the FBI. The evidence they handed over was a schematic of the atomic bomb, and I don't know how you coach a schematic." Now, to many of you, the Rosenbergs are these murky figures. I mean, what importance do they have to us today? Not much, except the uniformity with which the books deal with them is stunning. And by the way, after the Soviet Union fell and the KGB's archives were opened up, there were the Rosenbergs front and center as paid KGB agents. None other than former Soviet Premier Nikita Khrushchev said the Rosenbergs provided very significant help in advancing the Soviet atomic bomb. And we have to believe him, right? Because he's a communist and all the media tells us we gotta believe communists. Okay, how about this one? Line number 41, the transcontinental railroads never would have been built without the government, or as President Reagan used to say, government. Thomas Bailey and David Kennedy in a book called The American Pageant. Have any of you used this? This is a very, it's still a very popular book. It's probably the best-selling history book of all time. They say, quote, "Transcontinental railroad building was so costly and risky as to require government subsidies." John Blum, in another very good selling book called The National Experience, wrote, "Some form of public credit was essential to build the transcontinentals." Houston, we have a problem. These books completely ignore the only profitable transcontinental, a 100% privately built road built by a one-eyed Canadian entrepreneur named James J. Hill called the Great Northern. And there's old Jimmy, and that's his eye. I wanted to make sure he had both eyes for this presentation. When all the subsidized railroads failed in the 1893 crash, only the Great Northern Railroad continued running. Now, this one is timely, even though it seems innocent enough, because already a candidate for the U.S. presidency, Hillary Clinton, is suggesting we need more government subsidies and more help for various industries. Yet, did you know that neither Henry Ford with the automobile, nor the Wright brothers with the airplane, nor Eli Whitney with the cotton gin, nor Steve Jobs with a personal computer, or all of rock and roll music, I had to put that in, none of these had a dime of government support. In fact, any of you wants a great dissertation topic, it should be the capitalist elements of rock and roll music. Because rock and roll is a totally free market music that came up without any government help and became the number one music in the world. All right, how about this one? Line number 17, Sacco and Vanzetti were innocent. You guys probably aren't all that tuned into who Sacco and Vanzetti were. Nicola Sacco and Bartolomeo Vanzetti in April 1920 were two anarchists who robbed a factory paymaster and a security guard in South Braintree, Massachusetts, and they killed the guard in the process of the robbery. They were arrested for this and another robbery and were sentenced to death for shooting the guard. Critics claim they were only executed because they were political activists, not because they did the crime. Mark C. Carnes and John Garrity in the book American Destiny say, quote, "Their trial was a travesty, and they linked the execution of Sacco and Vanzetti to, quote, excesses of fundamentalists, xenophobes, and, of course, the Klan." These guys have the Klan on the brain. I'm telling you, some of these historians are probably closet Grand Dragons or something. Anyway, Gene Boydson's book, Making a Nation, says, "The state doctored evidence and witnesses changed testimony, but the judge favored the prosecution." Well, I guess that reaffirms the old line, what do you call a lawyer who doesn't know the law? A judge. Nevertheless, virtually every book implies or states that Sacco and Vanzetti were innocent based on the sole fact they said they were innocent. Imagine that, a murderer who said, "I was framed." Truth is, modern ballistics experts in the 1980s performed new tests on Sacco's gun and concluded that, in fact, it was the murder weapon. It wasn't tampered with, as historians claimed, that he and only he had access to the gun. It matched slugs found at both crime scenes. 9 witnesses saw Sacco at the scene of the shooting, and Sacco had other cartridges of the same make and caliber as those of the murder weapon in his pocket when he was arrested. I know you guys all walk around with shells in your pocket, but there you go. 30 years later, one of the witnesses who tried to provide an alibi for Sacco and Vanzetti admitted he lied. That didn't stop Massachusetts Governor Michael Dukakis from saying that it was a disgrace what happened to Sacco and Vanzetti. No, Governor, all disgrace is yours. To add a cherry on top, in 2005, a letter surfaced from socialist author Upton Sinclair, who once ran for governor of California, who championed the two, in which Sacco and Vanzetti's own attorney admitted to Sinclair that they had, in fact, murdered the guard and they had lied. One more before we get to Reagan. You've probably seen this picture. This is Chief Iron Eyes Cody, the famous crying Indian, who was featured in a 1979 Keep America Beautiful public service ad called People Start Pollution, People Can Stop It. I guess they've never listened to rap. By the way, I invite you all to the annual Schweikart Earth Day dinner, now moved to Chandler, Arizona. We have a giant celebration with a tire burning. You're required to arrive in a junk auto at least 30 years old, smoking like a chimney, and you're required to bring at least one covered dish of some extinct animal, spotted owl stew or snail darter surprise are my favorites, and we'll cap off the evening with our annual race between condors and bald eagles through the nearby wind farm. That's always exciting. Anyway, in this famous ad, viewers watched an Indian paddle his canoe up a polluted stream as smokestacks belt smoke out in the background, and then he walks to the top of a hill where you expect to see a glorious mountain range, and all of a sudden it's a highway and a car drives by and a bag of McDonald's lands at his feet, and this tear trickles down his cheek. It's all fake. The tear is glycerin. The chief is an Italian named Aspera Dougherty, born 1904 in Kaplan, Louisiana, to a family of Sicilian immigrants. Aspera Dougherty became an actor. He wasn't an Indian, but he played one over 100 times in films. Chief Iron Eyes symbolized the view that the Indians were the great protectors of the environment and whites were the great destroyers. And this is particularly true when it came to the issue of the buffalo. For example, John MacFarriger's book, Out of Many, a very popular text, says, quote, "The changes they produced," meaning whites, "the changes they produced in some areas were nearly as cataclysmic as those that occurred during the Ice Age." Now this shows you that not only do they not know history, they can't write. See if you can find the grammatical problem with this statement. "Having killed off the giant herds, ranchers and farmers quickly shifted to cattle." Having killed off the buffalo, they shifted to killing off cattle. Okay. All right. This particular passage lies in two separate ways. First, it fails to mention the fact that buffalo were being hunted to extinction before whites came on the scene. And second, it contains a partial truth that whites very nearly finished the job. You've all heard of Buffalo Bill Cody, who was an expert buffalo hunter and could kill 100 animals a day. But then it totally omits the most important part, which it was that conservationists and philanthropists saved the buffalo. As Princeton historian Andrew Eisenberg, Brown anthropologist Shepard Kretsch III, University of Montana professor Dan Flores all agree, Indians were hunting the bison to extinction before whites arrived. Less effectively, but the trajectory was still to extinction. Indians used techniques such as driving entire herds off a cliff for a hamburger, setting fire to the entire prairie to wipe out a herd. And the reason you've all heard this. Who has heard, well, you know, Indians used all parts of the buffalo. That's true, but it's not what it means. You think, oh, the Indian, here's a herd of buffalo that are dead on the prairie. It's like, and nothing's left, right? The locusts, you know, like. No, that's not what it means. It means at one time or another, Indians would use the bones. At one time or another, they would use the hides. They would use the blood. They would use the meat, but not all at one time. And we know this because eyewitnesses crossing the prairie would see entire herds of carcasses out there just rotting in the sun. Now, many of the, you say, why would they do this? Why would they kill entire herds? Well, some, not all, but some Indian tribes believed that the buffalo were infinite. Sort of like your view of your parents' money. What whites did was greatly accelerate the extinction process. There's no doubt from any quarter on that. It was white hunters who nearly polished off most of the buffalo herds. But by the way, it was, of course, industrialists who did use all parts of the buffalo. You can find things on Wikipedia, pictures of railroad cars just full of buffalo bones going back to be crushed up for glue and cement and other things. Then comes a part nobody tells you about. It was private ranchers and philanthropists who saved the buffalo. J.P. Morgan purchased some 20,000 acres in the West for bison and populated the land with herds. Ranchers bred beefalo, a combination of cow and buffalo, solely for its meat. Famous cattleman Charles Goodnight captured buffalo calves in 1878, developed his own private herd. In the 1900s, Goodnight shipped 700 privately raised and protected buffalo to Canada's Wood Buffalo National Park that became the basis for the current herd today of 14,000. By the mid-20th century, other ranchers boasted, "We supply buffalo for zoos, parks, circuses, and barbecues." Did you know that today there are more buffalo raised on private reserves solely for their meat than exist in all of the government parks put together? There are also ranches such as the Exo Ranch in Texas that raise incredibly exotic animals solely for hunting and as a result have repopulated the world with these animals. Exo Ranch has more of a certain type of antelope than exists in its native land of Pakistan today. Indeed, it was the titan of business, John D. Rockefeller, who likely saved the whales. Rockefeller, by developing low-cost, cheap kerosene, replaced the most common unit of interior illumination, which is whale oil. There's a really good movie. It just came out a little while ago, And the Sea Will Tell, something like that, about whaling. And there's a terrific speech in that movie where the minister is praying a prayer as they go out to hunt for whales, and he's talking about how, "Lord, give us the power to illuminate our houses and illuminate the world." They were using whale oil to illuminate the world, meaning they were killing whales right and left until Rockefeller came along and used kerosene. Yet how's Rockefeller portrayed? Standard Oil is dripping in blood. It's a giant octopus. In fact, I'm convinced when Jacques Cousteau and his people finally get to the bottom of the Marianas Trench, we're going to find that the whales have built a giant statue to John D. Rockefeller, and that once a year, like Muslims to Mecca, all the whales go in and pray, and do the whale thing. But the main focus of all the distortion in these books is Ronald Reagan. When parents ask me to tell if their kids' textbooks are biased, I say, go to the section on Reagan. It's like a pregnancy test of textbook bias. Well, Colbert thought that was pretty funny, so he showed a clip of me saying that on Fox and Friends. Then he showed a picture of Reagan pregnant, which I thought was cute. No matter how reasonable or fair a textbook is, when it gets to Reagan, it usually goes off the edge when dealing with the Gipper. As a result, in my book, I have four different entries on Reagan, but I'm only going to deal with two of them here today. Lie number 47, the Reagan tax cuts caused the massive deficits in debt. The textbooks absolutely lie about the Reagan years when it comes to coverage of the economy. A typical chapter concentrates on how tax cuts caused the massive deficits of the 1980s. Of course, nobody's talking about debt and deficits today because we have a president of a different party who's in office who's doubled the national, but let's forget that. None of them mention the fact that Reaganomics produced 14 million net new jobs. 14 million. Now, today, Obamanomics has produced 94 million Americans not even looking for work. Reagan produced 14 million net new jobs. In that entire period of the 80s, the Europeans, that would be the EU, the Europeans generated zero net new jobs. I would argue today that Germany would trade us Munich and two soccer players to be named later for 14 million net new jobs. But instead of celebrating the fantastic economic growth of the 80s, rising GNP, soaring employment, stable money, low interest rates, what do all of the textbooks, without exception, focus on? Deficits and debt. In fact, the tax cuts caused more government revenue. You can see government revenue rose by about 40%, but spending nearly doubled, and that would be the Democrat Congress. Now, I frequently argue to you that these books are biased. I'm going to prove it. Here's a chart from the American pageant that I mentioned before. The title isn't at the top, but if you look at the American pageant, you'll see this very chart. Let's go. Where are you? There you are. And this is on deficits over time, and it starts back in, I think, the 30s, and it goes all the way up through the Reagan years. And you can see in the Reagan years, it looks like, gee, these deficits are just off the charts crazy. And what was wrong with that crazy old man? But if you look up in the left corner, I don't know how many of you plan to go into economics, but there is something that economists always use, which is called real dollars. You never measure money from the 1800s against money today, because you could buy a steak dinner in 1920 for a nickel. Okay, you could buy a car for $300 in 1920. So you have to keep the dollars in real values. They didn't do that. So I got their data. I went back and got their data, and I adjusted it for real dollars. But then I said, you know what? Even that doesn't really address it, because what you owe is relative to what you spend, right? Some of you, your parents may have given you a credit card, and you get the bill, and you got $200. Oh, my dad's going to kill me. There's $200 on this card. If I get a Citibank bill, and I only owe Citibank $200, I go, oh, thank you, Lord. That's pretty good. If Bill Gates gets a Citibank bill, and he only owes $30,000, he says, eh, throw it on a pile till it amounts to real money and pay it. I'm not even going to bother with $30,000, right? So I adjusted it for real dollars as a share of GNP. Here's the chart. Not even the same chart, right? Not even close. But they're historians. They're not economists. Maybe they just made a mistake, huh? Maybe they just screwed up. No. Same chapter, same book, same topic, i.e. Reagan's an idiot. And here is a chart on the national debt. And look at how the debt just appears to skyrocket. Now, they do something here that is even worse. It's trickier. You got to really look closely to see this trick. There's a Sesame Street thing. Three of these things are kind of the same thing. One of these things is not quite the same. And you'll have a parakeet, and a boa constrictor. And you say, now, Susie, watch. Oh, the boa constrictor is different. Very good, Susie. All right. Let's play the Sesame Street game here. They put barcodes here. Depression. That's an event. World War II breaks out. That's an event. Japan surrenders. Event. Korean War. Event. Vietnam War. Event. Reagan! That's a person. See how they did that? See how clever that is? That's just a little form of additional bias. And of course, it's totally wrong. I did the same test on this. Share of GNP in real dollars. The chart is nowhere near the same. In fact, if you do it the right way, the national debt as a share of GNP was much higher under Kennedy, Eisenhower, Truman, and FDR. Okay? I actually overlapped the two. The overlap isn't perfect because they're different size charts, but you can get an idea. Okay. Probably the worst distortions of the Reagan record come in the area of his greatest success, which was ending the Cold War. This is where textbooks actually try to credit Mikhail Gorbachev for ending the Cold War. So lie number 9, Mikhail Gorbachev, not Ronald Reagan, was responsible for ending the Cold War. That's right. James West Davidson's book, Nation of Nations, tells us, quote, Gorbachev's reform policies led not only to the collapse of the Soviet Empire, but the breakup of the Soviet Union itself. See, all that military spending under Reagan, yeah, we didn't need all that. Good old Gorby was going to demilitarize the USSR by his little old self. George Brown Tyndall says in America, A Narrative History, Gorbachev also backed off Soviet imperial ambitions. Oh, I guess that explains it. That's why it took him 4 years to pull out of Afghanistan. He was backing off. Seriously, anybody who thought Gorbachev was going to give up the Soviet Empire only had to look at the birthmark on his head. Now, it's hard to see here, but right under his hand, he has this red birthmark. And I swear this is the truth. During the Soviet heyday, when they were going into another country, that birthmark would take on the geographic map shape of whatever country they were invading. And you could predict where they're going. Poland, he's going into, look, the Ukraine, I'm telling you. And I can prove this because after the Soviet Union fell, his birthmark went away. But it started coming back a few years ago when Putin started going into Georgia and Ukraine. Look, it's Georgia. He's going into Georgia. The ever reliable Unto a Good Land says, perhaps more important than Reagan, a new, younger leadership, the Kremlin allowed long dormant forces of change to emerge and drive the USSR toward democracy and a market economy. Now, as an aside, when this picture was taken, Gorby was 56 years old. I'm 65. Nobody would run around UD's campus and talk about that young and vibrant, new, young leadership of Schweikart, right? But he was young and vibrant compared to all the Soviet decrepit dictators that were literally decomposing on the throne of the Soviet Union. Chernenko, Andropov, Brezhnev, I mean, I find that name, these are the three guys that preceded him, right? Chernenko, he died in office. Andropov dropped off. Brezhnev died. And then Gorbachev comes in. Oh my gosh, he's only 50. He might last a year or two. When Reagan introduced the Strategic Defense Initiative in 1983, the media and liberals quickly labeled it Star Wars. This was to ridicule it. Well, in my day, if you wanted to ridicule something, you called it Buck Rogers. There were TV shows and movies called Buck Rogers about this guy who flew around in outer space. I mean, I'm sure you like the one up there. He doesn't even need a, you know, a mask. He just breathes that good old space air, you know. And they had similar shows like Commander Cody. This is my favorite. The Pentagon is working on this weapon right now, the bottom weapon, where you can kill an alien and unplug your toilet at the same time. It's a modern version of the Swiss Army knife. Anyway, Reagan, Americans did, they liked the term Star Wars. It wasn't negative to them for several reasons. One, by 1983, we had put men on the moon several times. We had space shuttles going up routinely. Space travel was considered normal. Two, we had lasers. We had lasers. We knew how to work lasers. That was not new. And third, everybody had seen the movie Star Wars. And everybody knew Reagan was Luke. Reagan was jaunty, young, optimistic. Yes, we can do it. There is a great true scene at Reykjavik, Iceland, when he meets Gorbachev for this summit. And Reagan comes out. It's freezing outside. He comes out in a suit just like this one, no hat, no scarf, and his cheeks are all tan. He just comes out, and he's all jaunty looking. Gorbachev arrives in one of those Soviet tanks called a car, you know, those horrible Soviet pillbox cars, and he gets out of this car, and he's got like 12 coats on and a little pillbox Russian hat, you know, and he walks like this, and the reporters are astonished. They go, my gosh, he looks 10 years older than Reagan, who was 10 years older than him. So Americans all knew that Reagan was Luke, and that meant that the Soviet dictators... I think he auditioned for the part. It's the same guy. And of course, that meant that Gorbachev was Darth Vader. Now, you all think of Darth because of the helmet, but when you take, it's Gorby. Put glasses on him. That even has a little red mark on his head. Fact is, Ronald Reagan's Star Wars was just one part of a massive strategy to bankrupt the Soviet Union. It scared the Russians to death because they knew we could do it. We did it in World War II. We built 95,000 tanks. One tank every 4 hours. We built 310,000 airplanes, including for 2 years, Russia's best fighter plane, the P-39 Air Cobra, which was so bad we wouldn't even let our own flyers fly it. I'm gonna give it to the Russians, okay? We built a Liberty ship, a ship, folks, in 4.5 days. This is less than it takes most of you to write one of your class papers. 4.5 days from scratch. Both Gorbachev and Reagan knew that with American computer technology, we could do Star Wars. They knew that with our technology, anything was possible. This is a cruise missile fired from 1,000 miles away at the state flower of Ohio. See, you guys don't get it. State flower, the orange pylons that come out every spring all over the highways. State flower of Ohio. Anyway, a pylon. They absolutely knew we could not overcome that. If you read liberal textbooks, you'd conclude that no American communist ever did anything wrong, that all business leaders are corrupt and evil, and that Bill Clinton never told a lie. I did not have sex with that woman, Miss Lewinsky. Now, listen. I am convinced Bill Clinton was talking to Monica when he said that. I did not have sex with that woman, Miss Hillary, hell no. No. It's always been you and me, baby. All kidding aside, this is important stuff. Margaret Thatcher said, guard your thoughts because your thoughts become your words. Guard your words because your words become your actions. Guard your actions because your actions become your habits. Guard your habits because your habits become your character. And guard your character because your character becomes your destiny. The left has been trying to steal our destiny by changing our thoughts about our character by recasting the past, and we can't let them do it. The Bible says it this way: death and life are in the power of the tongue. We cannot speak death to our country every day, to our families, to our schools, and expect anything other than what we are seeing in front of us today. Rather, we must search for the truth, speak it without reservation, even in the face of threats and intimidation, and future generations will all thank us very much for that. And now I'll take some questions from you guys.
Name and school, please.
Hi, my name is Hannah Payne, and I go to Unity Christian School. My question for you is, this past year I took AP US History, and my textbook was Give Me Liberty. And it kind of, once we got to the history of conservatism, started implying that because Goldwater voted against the Civil Rights Act, that conservatism had racist roots. Can you kind of expand on that and tell me how you would address that?
First of all, it is absolutely critical people understand the Democratic Party is the party of slavery. I can't say it any other way. They were, under Andrew Jackson, Martin Van Buren formed the Democrat Party for one reason only, and that was to protect and defend slavery where it then existed. Everything about the Democratic Party was set up to preserve slavery under Jackson and Van Buren, to perpetuate it. A gag rule was put in place so you could not even introduce a measure against slavery in Congress. Everything about, and he was very straightforward about that. The goal is to keep, and he did it for what he thought were good reasons, to keep a civil war from occurring. Because he knew that if a majority acted on slavery, that a civil war would eventually occur, which is what happened. The Democratic Party was the party of the Ku Klux Klan. It was founded by Democratic Party members like Nathan Bedford Forrest. And you've just got to understand that. So what they're trying to do when they address that is to flip the guilt to the other party. Goldwater's concern was with states' rights and incursions of the federal government on states' rights. We see it today. States cannot enforce labor laws. They cannot enforce immigration laws. They can't enforce anything because the federal government intrudes on that. And that was Goldwater's concern. By the way, since you brought up Goldwater, let me just throw this out. I've been doing a little interesting study of polls. And I've looked at June polls versus November polls. And it's kind of interesting. Did you know that June polls are more than likely going to tell you who won't win the presidency? If they're ahead in June, there's a slightly higher chance that person won't win the presidency and the other person will. And since you mentioned Goldwater, I'll tell you this. Everybody knows Goldwater lost in a landslide, right? Lost by 20 points. You know where he was in June? 57 points down. Goldwater made up 37 points in the election. Dukakis was up 27, lost by 8. That was a 35-point swing. So I just thought I'd bring that up since you mentioned Goldwater. But that's what they're trying to do, is change his concern for federal intervention to one about race. Yes, sir. Oh, over here. Okay, go ahead.
Eric Schneider, Parkhurst Academy. In your study of history, especially dealing with liberal textbooks and so on, what is the number one thing you get, like the one thing that you'd say is the hardest for conservatives to answer on the spot?
I think Hannah's question is close to that, having to do with Republican racism. The other one that you get a lot is the Great Depression. And because it contains so many myths, it's really hard to unravel. You've got to do it one myth at a time. That the stock market crash caused the depression, that Roosevelt gets us out of the depression, the federal spending, you know, all these, you've got to fight these one at a time. So I would say hers and that one are probably the two toughest ones. And you've got to get to a place where you can say, let's address these one at a time. Did the stock market crash cause the depression? No, it did not. Did Roosevelt's policies get us out of depression? Well, if they did, why were there still 14% unemployment in 1939, which is 2.5 times where Obama's unemployment is today, if you take that number for being real, right? Okay, over here.
Hi, my name is Harper Thomas. I'm from Shanghai American School. So contemporary historical accounts often portray Bush II as incompetent, if not downright injurious, because of his response to 9/11, Katrina, Abu Ghraib, and other issues. So do you believe this is justifiable, or is this another example of liberal propagandizing?
Let me put it this way. In retrospect, it's easy to say, oh, Iraq was a mistake. I ask you to put yourself in the position of President of the United States on even 2002, January 1, 2002. Who's coming to you saying that Iraq has weapons of mass destruction? Who is that? Well, the Russians. The Russians are giving, hey, you know, they not only have weapons of mass destruction, they're going to fire them at you. The Chinese. The Chinese intelligence agency says, hey, Saddam has WMDs. The French. French say, well, you know, Saddam has WMDs. The Brits. Saddam has WMDs. The Israelis. Saddam has WMDs. General Tommy Franks goes on a tour of Egypt and Jordan in 2002, and the king of Jordan says Saddam has WMDs, and the president of Egypt, Hosni Mubarak, who's later been deposed and killed, he says Saddam has WMDs. CIA says Saddam has WMDs. UN says Saddam has WMDs. You've got all this evidence in front of you, and every single piece of evidence, every country in the world says, you know what, Saddam has WMDs, and you're president, and you don't take him out. History would look very, very bad on you if anything at all happened. You could not afford to take that chance. So regardless of how it worked out, I think any rational person, even probably a Bernie Sanders, would make that same, given the evidence there, you know, the head of the CIA comes into Bush and says it's a slam dunk that he has WMDs. What are you going to do?
Fernando Andrade, La Quinta High School in La Quinta, California. I actually had to read a people's history this year in my history class. Yeah. Well, luckily, my teacher, he used it as an example of a way to see different perspectives in history and how historians kind of change and omit certain details in history to fulfill their agenda, which was good. It was kind of partial. But my question is that, did you use your cover as a way to respond to a people's history, and do you ever see your book used as much, used in popularity as a people's history in public schools?
When we first wrote it, our original title was The Cup of Hope, A Patriot's History of the United States. And we gave that to the publisher and go, you're crazy. You got to use this title, Patriot's History of the United States. So it was not a deliberate slam against Zinn. I would say, secondly, we are selling like crazy. We're over a third of a million sold. We are rapidly catching Zinn. I don't know if we can overcome him because, you know, a single college can order hundreds of books at a time. But we're making great inroads. I mean, for a conservative book to sell 350,000 copies is downright amazing. It's in use in over 30-some colleges and universities, and we just got another note over the weekend of another college adopting it and using it. I will say this about Zinn, and many of you are going to have people asking you to use Zinn or whatnot, and if you get in debates about Zinn, I think the answer is very easy. Show me his source notes. Where's that in his footnotes? Well, he doesn't have any. Well, let's look at the footnotes for Patriot's History. 40 pages of endnotes. Mike and I deliberately selected the most liberally accepted sources, not conservatives, liberal sources that we could for those notes. In other words, the endnotes of Patriot's History prove the point that Zinn is wrong, and they're from his side of the aisle. But again, just say, hey, let's take a look at the notes, because he doesn't have any.
This will be the last question.
Hi, I'm Danielle Espadini from Marysville Charter Academy for the Arts. I was wondering, how do you think young people should go about combating liberal propaganda and misinformation in the classroom?
Great question. I'm always asked this at every student conference. So you're all going to either go off to college. Some of you are in college. You're all going to go off to college. You're going to have biased teachers, most likely. And by the way, let me say one more thing to you. We do not pretend to be unbiased. Okay, Patriot's History is not an unbiased book. I think it is an accurate book, but I would not pretend to be unbiased. I think there's no such thing as an unbiased textbook. All right, so how to combat this? Recognize where you are, not just in terms of the battlefield you are on, you know, how is this going to be received? Recognize where you are. Do I need this class to graduate? My answer to you is, if you need the class to graduate, don't fight, okay? Do whatever he wants you to answer, and the day after you get your grade recorded on the college grade registrar, go back and say, you know what, you're full of crap. But if you need it, pick your battles. Don't be an idiot, you know? Don't die on a hill that's gonna destroy, but if God's calling you to do that, then by all means, go ahead and do it. But most of the time, God's, you know, take your grade in and go tell him afterwards, you know? Now, if it's a class you can afford to lose, don't stand by and let it go. That's the place where you can fight, you know? So pick your battles. You're not gonna win every battle, and you don't wanna get crushed before you start, but you don't wanna just roll over either. Pick your battles. A good general knows where he can fight and where he can't. All right, thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Schweikart.